It is Monday, June 27th, 2022. This is another edition of Baseball Today, presented to you by our friends over at Shady Rays, the best looking shades in the entire business. And on top of that, money back guarantee. If you don't like them, if you break them, if you lose them, they'll replace them. Best deal going in the biz. That is my man, T. Plouffe. I am Chris Rose, along for the producer, Rob, and intern Alden as well. Plouffe, I have missed you. I haven't seen you since last Wednesday. Joe's did a great job, as always, filling in. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing great. It's great to see your beautiful face, even though you don't like your lighting. I still am attracted to you because, you know, you want to know why?
Because I'm wearing so a much Baseball stuff. Today t-shirt.
Yeah, but there's just so much stuff that happened. I've been waiting to get this episode going, man. Like, I have lots of thoughts. We just need to get them out to the people.
Yeah, so let's do that. I'm on the road up in Northern California. Brady's got a little baseball camp up here, so the family's up. We're going to have a good time. But let's start by talking about the brawl. And I contemplated not starting with this because there's so much other big shit that happened in the world. But I think there's so few good base brawls going these days that I had to. Plus, I texted with Jesse Winker while he was in the clubhouse after he got ejected. I was just like, dude, are you okay? He's like, Rose, I'm great. I'm from Buffalo. That shit happens all the time.
Oh my God. Down on Chippewa Street in Buffalo, that happens all the time.
Exactly. Bill's Mafia when we're jumping through tables before we lace it up against the Dolphins. This is how we react anyway. All right, so as a former major leaguer, take me through your thoughts watching it.
I was surprised at some of the shots that were thrown there. You know, like you see J.P. Crawford coming over the top. There was players on coaches, people at the bottom of the pile. It was a good old-fashioned Donnybrook, if you will. I don't know what the initial words that were exchanged between, I think it was Winker and Nevin. They didn't really go into it. There were some things said. That was kind of like what we got from Nevin. But whatever started it, it went on for what, like 7, 10 minutes?
Yeah, because it settled and then it rekindled and all that sort of stuff. Listen,
I don't like it. Okay. I don't like fights on the baseball field because you got how many guys on the field? 50 to 60 people on the field. Oh, yeah. You have to keep your head on a swivel. Here's Iglesias throwing the seed.
That was incredible.
There is so much going on here, Chris. Again, I know it's entertaining for the fans. So like in that regard, like, you know, look, we're an entertainment business, but I don't necessarily I never liked being in brawls. If you say you like being in brawls, I think you're lying because it is just too many people out there. And, you know, one bad punch could end someone's career.
Was it good for the sport though?
Probably. Did you, I mean, there's things like, did you hear about like the pizza that got delivered? Oh. And now everyone's sending the delivery driver tips. So this guy's making cash. He's probably made five figures in tips.
Easily. There's no question. Yeah. The whole story about the Mariners fan in Arkansas who ordered the pizza, they got delivered to Winker. I texted him. I said, how was the pizza?
He goes, actually,
it was great. Yeah. He said it was great. He really appreciated it. The whole thing. Now, there's the entertainment side, as long as nobody gets hurt, of the fight itself. Then there's the reason it happened, right? Now, we remember last week in Seattle that Michael Lorenzen said, listen, the ball was slippery. That's the reason Justin Upton got hurt.
Yes.
Everybody believes him. There's no question about that. But these teams have been playing a lot over the last couple of weeks. And then Trout gets his tower buzzed on Saturday night, talked about how he wasn't happy about it. And then the Angels change out and they have an opener. I mean, this is when the baseball judiciary people sit down and look at this today, they don't have a choice but to say, wait a second, why did they make a last second change and put in this Watts guy to go be the opener? I'm sorry, that if we're, it's a hard thing to figure intent. I'm not calling for a suspension of Phil Nevin, but if he gets a hefty suspension, it would not shock me here because of that move.
Yeah, to have him start the game, have someone immediately warming up. He throws one behind J-Rod's head and finally gets Winker. I've talked about this before. Look, you get one shot, okay? Like, you don't get unlimited shots at a team. If you decide that's the route you want to go, you can't just keep throwing it, guys. Like, that's just not how the game works, and that's why Winker is upset. Okay. Like they didn't believe there was any intention with Trout, which, you know, believe that or not, like they thought the game was going to be played just regular old game. Then the J-Rod thing happens, then Winker gets hit, and then the melee ensues. But the opener thing's very, very fishy. It's very, very fishy. And they are going to have to take that into account. And Jimmy's breakdown, guess what, will be part of the process. So I can't wait till that comes out. It's the layers on this thing, I think, are just starting to get exposed. I think we're going to learn a lot about this melee.
I think the baseball has to take a strong stand on the Angels here. I really do. And I know that a lot of people say, well, hold on, if Winker just went to first, then there wouldn't be a problem. And that's fine. You know, I think that Jesse Winker will get popped a couple of games. There's no question. And the double bird to the fans, although that sort of stuff doesn't bother me. He did apologize afterward. He said, that's the only regret I have is that I did that. I don't think he had to say to the women and children. I think if you just say, hey, listen, I shouldn't have done that, that's fine. But I really believe that I think baseball should act harshly on the Angels here. I think they have to take you don't have to be the person that created baseball or the person that created the opener to understand what they were doing on Sunday. And that's dangerous. That's really dangerous. If this is the way we're going to go, because the rest of other 28 teams are going to be watching this. And if they say, well, it's okay to have an opener, to have a sacrificial lamb out there who's going to take it for the team as long as we don't have to sacrifice our starting pitcher, then guys are going to get thrown at a lot more. And I don't want to see that.
You know what's messed up, C. Rosie? Is this all stemmed from like what you're saying with Lorenzen and the slick balls? Like, baseball needs to figure this out. I forgot to bring it up on this show. But, you know, we're always wondering, are these balls really slick? What are these pitchers talking about? We understand that they've gotten, you know, they're getting checked now, so they can't exactly do everything they used to do on the ball. But you still get the balls rubbed up. You still have the rosin back there. When I caught that foul ball at Dodger Stadium, I was playing with it. It was slick. It was like, if I was playing at third base and I caught that ball, the first thing I would do was I'd go to the mound and I put a bunch of rosin on my hand to try to get a hand, like some tack on it, because those balls are slick. And we're seeing a lot of pitches get away from pitchers in the major leagues right now. Okay. And like, you can say, hey, they're just trying to throw. They're not pitchers anymore. They're trying to throw the ball as hard as they can and make the pitch move as much as they can. But like, it's the balls are also slick. So we have to figure that out, or else we're going to get stuff like Upton getting hit in the head. We're going to get stuff like, which we'll get to, Harper getting hit in the hand. Like, they need to figure something out with these balls. Cause look, this is a consequence of it.
It is. And I'm not trying to downplay it, but with all that being said, Upton getting hit in the head did not lead to the Mariners buzzing Trout's tower. The reason that happened was because he's got 53 career homers against him, and they have to stop throwing over the plate. Now, did he miss? Was he trying to go lower inside and missed high? Very possible. Is it because of a slick ball? Absolutely possible. And you're right. It boils down to several different areas that baseball's got to look at. First and foremost, though, is, and they're probably going to rule today, and we're going to be talking about the ruling tomorrow. I hope they don't screw it up here, but we'll see. We'll see. All right, Astros and Yankees, they split their four-round title fight. Boy, oh boy, what a weekend in the Bronx. We had a pair of walk-off hits by Aaron Judge. We had a combined no-hitter on Saturday. So what was the biggest headline for you to come out of this series?
I think it was all-encompassing. Like, this is baseball. This is two juggernauts going at it. This is what we want to see in the postseason. I mean, these two teams don't like each other. They match up very well against each other. And you see, I mean, the Yankees get no hit, and then they go into the Sunday's game and they're getting no hit through what, 5-6 innings. And then they come back. Like, this is like, they're a great team. I think the most entertaining part of this entire series for me was that there were some bookend homers. So Altuve hits the first pitch of the game for homer, right, and then Judge eventually walks the game off with a homer. I just think it was good baseball. And if you're at the stadium, which, you know, we follow a lot of guys who are Yankee fans that were at the stadium. I mean, the emotions, you know, you see Joe's there wondering if the Yankees are ever going to get a hit again. And then at the end of the game, he's celebrating because Judge is hitting the gritty walking across the plate. So just excellent baseball. This is what baseball is made to be like those two teams going at it. I thought the whole thing was incredible. The Astros pitching was The starters were great. I just think that they match up so well against each other that we have to get this in the postseason. I'm praying that nothing funny happens and we get to see these two teams match up in the LCS.
So if there's a way, I think two fan bases should feel great about their World Series chances today. Great about it. If you're Houston, you say after the first inning of the four game series, after the very first, our starting pitchers gave up two earned runs, two earned runs to the best team in baseball. If you're the Yankees, you say, holy shit, we got smacked around all weekend over 4 days. And if it wasn't for three innings, we would have been on the wrong way of a four game sweep. But you know what? We did have some of those special innings.
We got Aaron Judge.
And well, right. Well, they have to, he's part of the huge reason they've got 10 walk-off wins this year. Yeah. And almost 20 come from behind victories or whatever it is.
I think it's like 22.
22. That's remarkable, right? There's teams that don't have 22 wins, I think, let alone come from behind victories. So both teams should feel great about where they are. And both teams should be on their own respective Twitterverse saying, we're the team to beat. And I don't care that the Yankees have a better regular season record than the Astros right now, because if these two teams played seven games, it's going to end up 4-3 one way or another. And I don't know who's going to win. I need to see who's healthy at that time. I need to see who's got good mojo at that time, that whole bit. But if you don't root for another American League team, you damn well better root for this series to happen in late October, because it will be memorable.
You know, and this all happened in the Bronx. Like, going down to Houston will be electric too. Like, these are two very passionate fan bases, two places that get really, really loud. It's a must watch baseball right now when these two teams go up against a number one, because of the backstory of all the things that have gone on. Number two, just these are, I mean, they're two of the top four teams in baseball. How about that? They might be the best two teams in baseball.
Yeah, I'll be honest with you. I think they're one and two.
Yeah, because the Dodgers are hurting right now with the injuries. Mm-hmm. I agree. Yeah, best two teams in baseball. Fuck it, I'll say it.
Yep. Robbie, do you know the next time? When do they go to Houston? When do the Yankees go to Houston? Do we know then when that is? I should have looked that up ahead of time. All I can tell you is I'm
super excited. Hey, let's go. Let's go.
That'd be a great series. Fun series to go to. Let's go. I will tell Yankee fans, and I think John Heyman wrote about this in the New York Post, perhaps they should rethink their whole let's boo the shit out of a Jose Altuve thing, because it ain't working. Like, maybe just stand up. It starts.
What?
They go Thursday? This Thursday, they're back in Houston?
Oh, yeah, baby.
The 30th.
Oh, we
can't go, but.
I'm almost like bummed. It feels like it's too soon. Or should it's we just capitalize?
It's what? It's a one game. I think it's a makeup maybe or something.
No, it's not a makeup, because there have been scheduled one game series this year. Like, the Giants had one at Milwaukee earlier this year because of the whole late start thing. So they must be going back.
They're going back July 21st.
Oh, ooh,
where am I in July 21st?
Two game series.
July 21st. Yeah, that's no good.
Oh no, it's a doubleheader. Yeah.
So
on July 21st,
that's it. So they make two.
Yeah.
So they make two one-day stops in Houston?
I think so, yeah.
What a weird schedule. Yeah, what is going on?
July 22nd Yankees play the Orioles.
That's bizarre. Okay. And well, good.
You know what? That's
the first
weird
game after the All-Star break, too.
Sure as heck is. You're right.
Whatever happens in these games, who cares? Like, that's such a weird scheduling thing. Like, they'll probably split the doubleheader, and then whoever wins this game, I don't know, man. That's crazy to me.
That's really bizarre. And then the Yankees
should just not play. You know what? Just not play anymore and just wait for the playoffs.
Ha!
You can't beat this series that just had.
I know. It was great. Well, baseball today presented to you by these guys, Shady Rays. And if you think I look good in these things, imagine how great you will look when you slide these on the bridge of your nose. Here's the thing I love about Shady Rays. Not only do you look great, and all of a sudden that someone special in your life is like, yeah, you look cool. They have every pair backed by lost and broken replacements. So that means if you lose or you break a pair, even on the first day that you own them, they will send you a brand new pair. That is unbelievable. Have you ever heard of that? Because like at least three times a year, I lose my shades or I sit on them in my car and I break them with my fat ass. The fact that I can replace them, that is a home run. On top of that, this company warms your heart. You're probably like, what are you talking about? Well, Shady Rays provides 10 meals to fight hunger in America with every order. In fact, to date, they have donated over 20 million meals. So you look great. You can replace them if they break or they get lost. And you're helping to feed America. That is a win, win, win. Oh, one other thing. If you don't love these things for whatever reason, I haven't met one person who says, man, my Shady Rays suck. They will return them for free within 30 days. So what I need you to do, go to ShadyRays.com. Use the code today for 50% off 2+ pairs of premium polarized shades. That's ShadyRays.com. Use the code word today. Trust me, you will be happy. All right, let's move on to some bad news. Bryce Harper out indefinitely. Broken thumb. Took 97 right on his hand from Blake Snell the other night. Pissed as a motherfucker, as was I. Afterward, Harper said, listen, I was just mad. He said he's been playing against Blake Snell since he was 11. He gets it. It's part of the sport. But, man, he was fuming. Big picture here. After the Phillies took 3 of 4 in San Diego, last 2 or 1.5 without Harper, is their season over?
Oh, boy. See, Rose, why are you making me do this?
Because it's probably a question, unfortunately, that needs to be asked.
Probably. Like, yeah. Like, if you're really being truthful about it, I mean, how are you going to replace a Bryce Harper? But then as soon as you say that, people will say, well, what about Ronald Acuna last year in the Braves? That's what they'll say. I think the Braves are probably last year a little bit more of a complete team. They did go and like were very aggressive, rebuilt their outfield, and those guys really stepped up. So that, I mean, you could make moves and you can have guys step up. They're definitely going to have to do that. I mean, right now to replace Bryce Harper, I mean, you just can't do that. You're going to have guys like Castellanos or Realmuto step their game up and do it right now. I mean, Hoskins is having a good year. Schwarber's having a good year offensively. Maybe letting Castellano get some more DH days now will help him. We know Bryce has been DHing exclusively because of the arm. Castellanos has been out in the outfield. Maybe he needs a break. Maybe that'll bring his bat back. But they're going to have to find help internally, guys already on their roster. And then they're probably going to have to go do some stuff at the trade deadline. You know, Dombrowski's known to do that. I don't want to say it's over because they still have some very good ball players on their team. They've had a great June, but I mean, I think like Braves missing Acuna last year and winning the World Series is kind of a one-off story. I hate to say it to Philly fans. I was probably the biggest believer in the media with the Phillies, but I don't think they can overcome this, man. I don't think they can.
Since the beginning of 2021, the Phillies have averaged almost 1.5 more per game with Bryce Harper in the lineup than when he's missed games.
It's a good stat.
And I think it's about 30 games that he's missed since the beginning of 2021. I'm bummed.
Your question then.
No, it can't. It's not going to happen. It's not. It's a balanced, challenged roster as is when he's in the lineup. So without him, that's why he gets MVP votes. Because when you take him out of a lineup, we're talking a run and a half. I didn't say a half that's run crazy. Per game. I said 1.5 runs. Is there a guy that counts that much in a team's lineup?
Maybe Judge.
Right. We haven't seen it that much. Since the beginning of 2021, he's played a lot of baseball, which is good.
We both said it's most likely over. There's a glimmer of hope. Like if you're a Phillies fan, I wouldn't give up on the season just yet. Let's see what happens. Let's see how can this look. I didn't think Rob Thompson was going to be a spark that sparked him. You know, sometimes adversity mm-hmm. brings another spark. We'll see if they can turn this into a positive. I hope doesn't look sucks. Like you though.
Yeah. It just doesn't feel good. And let's remember with the Braves last year, it was the perfect storm. They were not over 500 till early August. They were the beneficiary of a shit division.
Yeah.
If that happened, if Acuña went down in early July of this season, they would have zero chance of catching the Mets. Zero. Now, some people will say, well, look at the injuries the Mets have dealt with. And there's no question. DeGrom hasn't thrown a pitch. Scherzer's been out more than half the year. That's a great point. And they battle a lot of other injuries here and there. But Bryce Harper is, he's 101.
And eight games back right now in the division for them. That's,
well, I'm just
even with Bryce Harper, that's tough to come back. That's almost insurmountable. But you're talking without him, I don't know, man.
Well, I mean, but I thought of them as a wild card team this year. Sure. I think I had them as a wild card team before the season started. They're only 1.5 out. Can they catch the Giants, who are currently they're just out.
Expanded Cardinals. Playoffs clearly helped them. You know, that's a plus. That's a plus if you're a Phillies fan. I just think, look, let's see surgery. He's out for the season. If he doesn't require surgery, maybe you get him back towards the end of the year, and then you can start to dream. Okay, if you're Dave Dombrowski and he can be back this year, I think you're probably a little bit more aggressive in trying to stay in the fold here. If he's out the entire year, maybe you're not as aggressive. So I think first things first, we have to see what they say. He's going to visit two specialists, get a couple different opinions before they decide what they're going to do. But the whole thing sucks. And, like, you know, the interaction with him and Snell, Bryce is fired up. You know, he obviously knew what Snell didn't do it on purpose.
Right.
Another ball just getting away. It's horrible, man.
By the way, I think it was somebody in The Athletic that covers the Phillies, and I apologize for not getting the name. That's my fault. Talked about if Harper has surgery, do they then push the issue on him getting his partially torn UCL fixed so that he's really ready to go in 2023? I'm just saying, there's a lot on the table. I'm sure we'll have more news coming out in the next couple of days. We got to move on. Freddie Freeman, his return to Atlanta was something special, something neither of us, I'm sure, had ever seen in the baseball world, where a guy was constant waterworks. He got his ring before Friday's game. Place went nuts. There weren't boos until he stepped in the batter's box as the opponent. Like, there was a minute standing ovation before he became the opponent, if you will. But he was teary-eyed, snickered, basically told him, hey, take deep breaths, man. You're going to be okay. This is going to be all right. But it was constant. I want to ask this. If you're a Dodger teammate, are you sitting there wondering, is he on board with us or not?
I don't think you asked that. I think you understand, like, this was maybe closure or the beginning of closure for him, like going back and
not what he said.
Well, you know, I think he might feel that way in a couple of days. Okay. Like, the dog days are coming. He's, you know, they have some injuries of their own. So, like, they need Freddie to be superstar Freddie. Okay. I think he had a great series that I think the exchange of the last game when he hits the single to go ahead or what he hits the hit to go ahead, then Olsen comes back and ties it up in the 10th. I thought that was really cool. I'm not worried if I'm his teammate. I understand that, like, he's played there a long time, many relationships there. He basically became a man in the Braves organization. So, like, there are some emotions there. I don't think it's going to affect, like, the way he plays or anything like that. I'm not worried about that at all. He's an emotional guy. Like, we found that out about Freddie.
Totally. Had a long talk with him about his contract issue.
Yeah.
Long chat about it.
Are you worried about it? Like,
I am a little bit. I am.
Like, in what way?
Here's what I think. I think that a couple things can be true. I think that he can enjoy his new teammates and his new home and still miss where he was. I don't think it has to be one or the other. And I want to give you, for instance, and it's very, very different. When I joined on here in early 2021, after a month, I knew, like, this is a great place for me. Like, I'm really happy. But I was still very sad after having spent a decade at MLB Network. Now, yeah, it is a little different, okay? Unlike the Braves, I wasn't asked back to MLB, so I had to deal with those emotions. And in an interview I gave The Athletic, I don't know, 6 or 7 months ago, people are like, wow, Rose still hasn't moved on. Because something's such a big part of your life for a decade, and you build such strong bonds and relationships that it is tough to move on. And I think that we forget that these guys are human beings, that just because they put on a new uniform doesn't mean like, hey, this is it. I've changed everything about myself. No, he hasn't changed. The reason I think we all love Freddie Freeman is because this is exactly who he is. He's like big blubber fest. Like when he gets to first base, he's the welcoming committee. He's hugging guys. He's patting guys, telling them good job. Like he's the social chair of MLB. And for us to expect him to put on Dodger blue and all of a sudden everything that's happened to him in Atlanta is forgotten. No. And that Clayton Kershaw quote where he said, you know, I hope we're not playing second fiddle because I think he'll realize we have pretty special guys here. I think he will. But to ask him to just listen, if you were to lock him down and put a lie detector test on him, would he want to be back in Atlanta? Yes. And that's no shame on the Dodgers.
Yeah, I mean, look, let Freddie be himself. The one thing you don't want is your teammate feeling like he's got to like make an emotion up for you. Like you don't like in no world would a guy who's done what he did in Atlanta and has like accomplished the things and lived as long as he did in Atlanta for him to come over and just be like, screw them, I'm a Dodger now, like LA. It's like, that's not true. That's not Freddie. You know, like I think this is totally fine. He's going to go out there and perform. He's a professional baseball player. He's going to act professional on the field. If he is a little emotional, who cares? The guy's going to go out and play his butt off for the Dodgers. Okay. That's the bottom line. So I'm not worried about it at all. I think it's actually really cool.
I do
too.
See
Freddie go through this. Like, you know, look, as you get older, I'm crying all the time now for some reason. I think like once you have kids, you start to cry a little bit. I watched Top Gun in the theaters and I was like crying in there, like at least tearing up. It's just part of growing up, man. Like if you're in touch with your emotions like Freddie is, don't hide that. It's fine.
Yep. By the way, he went 4 for 12. They won 2 of 3. Big time comeback last night, getting a couple off Kenley to force extras and then winning it. All right. Bigger story. We got to move quickly on this one for Boston. Then it's won 7 in a row, is 19-4 this month, or hasn't picked up a game on the Yankees in the month of June.
Hey, they are sneaky going off right now. I had them as a 500 team because I wasn't sure about the starting pitching. I'm talking about preseason. Then they came out and were horrible to start the year. And I felt like, you know what? Maybe I was right, but they've come back. And people say we don't talk about them enough. I'm glad we got him in on the YouTube portion here because usually we're talking about them on the back end and amp. What they're doing is incredible. Yeah, they're not happy. They've only picked up a half game. The Yanks are playing awesome, but like they're trying to cement their way into the playoffs. Right now. That's really all they care about, you know, catch the Yankees, whatever. They want to make it to the playoffs, and them going on this run has really obviously helped their chances of getting there. I think it's a really fun team to watch. You know, I think obviously they can hit the ball. Their pitching has been good. They're still going to get some guys back with Sale and Whitlock. Like, They're a team that, you know, we really, I think, as a baseball world, haven't paid enough attention to just because of the start they got off to. This is going to be a fun team. We know they're going to come to play. We'll see how the rest of the year goes from the great run here. The Yankees could – I told the Yankee fans this. They're riding so high right now. Like, there's going to be a lull for them. I don't know how big it's going to be, how long it's going to last. But they're not going to play this well all throughout the season. So Boston needs to know that half game after winning all these is not ideal, but I think they're just happy that with how they're playing, they're not worried about the Yankees.
I'm with you. They just want to make it to October. And I will tell you this, the Yankees and the Astros, they won't admit this. And the players don't care because they're like, well, whomever we have to play, we have to play. It's more of a fan thing. No fan base in Houston or New York wants to see Boston come out of the wild card round. They just don't. They don't. With Alex Cora there, we know what they can do. I like the way that they're approaching their at-bats at the plate. Yesterday, 15 hits and 11 walks against Cleveland pitching. They're a top five OPS team, despite only having 70 home runs, which I think is like tied for 20th. They're not mashing home runs. That's not what they do. But still, they're top five in OPS, which means they're hitting a shitload of doubles. They're taking some extra bases here. They're running a little bit, even though they don't have the most athletic team around. I love the way they're playing right now. Love it. Except yeah,
a lot of veterans taking really good ABs. Trevor Story's his overall numbers not great, but he's been really well with runners in scoring position. Yep. So it's like, how could you hate on that? That's kind of what you need. They're going to be an interesting watch here come down to the wire. We'll see what they do at the trade deadline.
Yeah, they'll be interesting. Before we get out of here, let's we started it with some fighting the show. Let's end it with some serious love. Given out Saturday on the south side of Chicago, 7-year-old Bo Dowling, he's fighting neuroblastoma, goes out. Both the Orioles and the White Sox are lined up along the chalk. He hits the home run. He circles the pillows. He throws out a great first pitch. Dude, it just warms your heart. The best part is that all the big leaguers are out there to slap five. It'd be one thing if he was just out there on his own, throwing a first pitch to their woolly little mascot. But the fact that there are 52 big leaguers out there to enjoy the moment and see how special it was for this 7-year-old kid who has more fight in him than most of us will ever have in our lifetime is something special. Thumbs up, Bo. Thumbs up, White Sox. Thumbs up, Orioles.
Yeah, Bo, we're thinking about you here too. I'm glad you had a fun day at the ballpark. And yeah, I mean, that is something that's 100% needed to happen. Everybody out there cheering this guy on. It hits home. Anybody that has a kid understands, man. Now you're going to get me to tear up again.
Yeah. Listen, Teddy's 7.
Shout out, Bo.
Yep.
Keep fighting, bro.
Yeah. We're proud of you, man. Keep loving baseball. Keep doing your thing and take that as a special memory. I'm sure that you and your family will cherish it forever. Great, great job. Quickly, what do you have coming up on John Boy? You and Jake?
Me and Jake, Monday recap episode. Lots of stuff happened. We're going to have a great episode, man. Mondays are my favorite. And then when Jake and I get together, things get a little weird on the show.
I like that.
But it's a good weird. What about
all
you?
More weird. Latest episode of the Rose Rotation with Tyler Matzik of the Atlanta Braves and his former teammate Josh Tomlin, who is enjoying not quite retirement because he might come back next year, but he's mouthy in a good way, in a fun, fun way. This is a fun episode. Yeah.
That clip you put out about them knowing about the Tommy Pham thing is awesome. Like another layer to that story.
I know, right?
It won't stop. That story won't stop, dude.
I couldn't believe it. I know the look on my face is hilarious. Everybody was like, the look on your face when they said that he didn't leave the clubhouse for 3 days in San Diego, but they've got a ton of great stories. We got another one, Matt. There's another twist to the Matzik cop parade story that we're going to drop later today. It's the episode is well worth listening. It's a fast listen. And Matzik takes us through his whole struggle and the Navy SEAL that helped fix his baseball life. Essentially, it's really, there's the look. That's it. Yeah, there it is.
That's pretty fun.
Looks about right. All right, we got to get out of here. We went a little long, but it was a bloated Monday. We deserve it. For our producer, Rob Scirocco, our intern, Alden Stone, my man, T. Ploop, I'm Chris Rose. We'll see you Tuesday on Baseball Today.